Good morning. How's everybody this beautiful day? So how's everybody doing this beautiful day? That's better. Well, welcome to Calvary Chapel. If you're new to the fellowship, if you look in your bulletin, there is a little white slip. If you'll fill that out and drop it in the offering box, which is in between the two doors as you exit, we will get in touch with you, answer any questions you may have, get to know you, or anything that we might be able to help you with. Also, if you have a prayer request, turn it over and fill out the back. Write that request on the back. And also drop that off in the offering box. And all through the week, we will be praying for you. Okay. We had our men's breakfast yesterday morning, and the Lord's good. We had a neat time. The word went out, and it was really neat, really convicting to get our lives together as men. And so, ladies, you're next. We're in the process right now of working on our women's, I don't know what you call it, tea or breakfast or whatever. So we'll have to work on that one. But it is in the process. So it should be in the bulletin within the next week or so. So ladies, pray for us because we're getting it ready for you guys. Okay. We can use some help in cleaning up the amphitheater, which is up top. If you have over here. Oh, okay, our outside theater, got it. When it said amp, I think, well, that's upstairs, that's where all the amps are. What do I know? I'm just supposed to know, but that's okay. Okay, our outside theater. So that we can begin going, since the weather's warming up, going outside and rejoicing in the Lord outside. So if you're willing to help, see me, or you can see back in the back, Jack, if you would raise your hand and wave. He knows more than I do, so he won't look at it and go, what? Okay, if you look to the left of your bulletin, there is a list of ministries. There's Bible studies on Mondays, Tuesdays, our Wednesday night study, Thursday morning, Saturday morning prayer. We have those things because they're important. One, our prayer time, we know our church doesn't move unless it's wrapped in prayer. We want to go the right way. We want to glorify God in all things that we do, and in all things that we do, we wrap in prayer. Our Bible studies are to help us to get where we should be in the Lord, but it's also a time of fellowship. Also a time of fellowship on those things of God. We are called to be one in Christ, one body, and so. If you're just coming to Sunday mornings, I just want to say this. You're missing an awful lot. There's some really sweet people in the fellowship, and it's always neat to get to know one another and build relationships because that's what God has called us to do. That's what Jesus prayed for in the garden. Lord, let them be one as you and I are one. So take a look at those list of ministries. Find out which ones that you're able to go to, and I want to encourage you, if you can, to be there. Okay, Sunday school is in need of some help. If you feel that you love to deliver the word to the young people and be a part of that, we can take care of that for you. You can see me in the back. We'll get your name and all that stuff, and then we'll get you started. Worship team is also looking for people who could sing. I tried out, and they almost didn't let me come back to the church, period. So I knew that from the beginning because I can't even sing. So if you can sing, if you can't sing, if you can make a joyful noise, See, right here, the young man playing, he's in charge of that, and he'll take care of you. Okay, we have a minister of the month, and it's on the backboard with some information if you want to find out what our ministries are all about. They're on the backboard, so take a few minutes as you exit the building. Okay, I'm going to leave you with this. Psalms 150. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his firmament of his power. Praise him in his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of trumpet. Praise him with a psaltery and harp. Praise him with a timbrel and dance. Praise him with the string instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's why we're here this morning. We're here to come together, one body in Christ, to praise the Lord together, to shout his praises, to lift our voices to him. And he says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. That's you and me. So today, be prepared for what God's going to do in your heart. The word goes forth, and the word doesn't come back void. Open your heart to see what God has for you today, and let's just worship him in his sanctuary with all that we have. Okay, stand up, find somebody you don't know, and say good morning. Glad you're here. God bless you guys.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Calvary Chapel. We are here to seek the Lord and sing some praise songs to him. And the first one we're going to sing is called Nobody Loves Me Like You. It's a Chris Tomlin song, excuse me. And I just want you to know, nobody does love you like Jesus. Amen? So why don't we all stand up and sing this song to him. I see you in the sunrise every morning. It's like a picture that you painted for me. A love letter in the sky. story. I could have had a really different story, but you came down from heaven to restore me. Forever save my life. Nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, you are faithful and true. Nobody loves me like you. Mountains, you're breaking down the weight of all my mountains. Even when it feels like I'm surrounded, you never leave my side. Oh, nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, you are faithful and true. Nobody loves me like you. Oh, what a God we serve. 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 My heart keeps singing. Oh, what a God we serve. Oh, what a God we serve. Oh, what a God we serve. Jesus, you love me, and I love you, God. Nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, you're faithful to you. Forever worship you. Nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, I will worship you, forever worship you. Yes, we love you, Lord.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? When all the saints are singing, that's what's going to happen, and we're going to do it. So let's practice now.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing of Jesus Christ, the saving one. We can see that God, you're moving, a mighty river through the nation. When young and old will turn to Jesus. Hey! Fling wide you heavenly gates. Prepare the way of the risen Lord.
Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing.
and songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon injustice. Do you feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song? And all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness. And here we see that God, you're moving. A time of jubilee, it's coming. When young and old return to Jesus. Hey, fling a wide to heavenly gates. Prepare.
Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing. And songs that bring your hope, songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon injustice.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Love you, Lord.
You guys can be seated if you'd like.
Lord, I come. I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Oh, Jesus, you're my hope and savior. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. In the morning, when I rise, when the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, oh, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. Oh, you can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, when I am alone, when I am alone, just give me Jesus. Sing it out to him now. Oh, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Oh, you can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I come to die, when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, just give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Oh, you can have all this world, just give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Oh, you can have all this world. Yes, you can have all this world. You can have all this world. Just give me Jesus.
Amen. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen. He's awesome.
All right. Give me Jesus. What's it going to be when we take our last breath? What that's going to be like when we step into glory? Give me Jesus. He's with us throughout our lives in many respects. He never lets go. I just praise God for worship. I praise God for this time. This is our fifth Sunday. We offer our fifth Sundays. A family's going to stay in and train their children. No, expose them to just what we're doing here as a family. We're going to have communion today as a family. And we're just going to take advantage of the blessings of these little cherubs and the magic of youth and the wonderment of our children. So as we open up our Bible study today, let's open up in a word of prayer. And we are going to finish the book of Colossians. Yeah. I want to go into the book of John next time, so as we come back together, and the gospel. So let's open up in prayer. Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for worship. We thank you, Lord, for just the centering of the fact that, Lord, you are so powerful and so gracious to us, Lord. We come before you asking, God, that you join us as we open up your word. For, Lord, it is your word that gives us direction. It is your word that gives us strength. It's your word that inspires us, Lord, and convicts us and encourages us. And, Lord, as we focus our worship to you in word, Lord God, we ask that you just meet us where we're at. As we draw nigh unto you, Lord, draw nigh unto us. May your Spirit teach us and lead us, encourage us and strengthen us as, Lord, we go from this building, going out in that world that so desperately needs you, that is so hard to navigate at times without you. But, Lord, we know we need you so much. Join us, strengthen us, encourage us, and we put this service in your hand. In Jesus' name, amen. We are Colossians chapter 2. Verse 16. How does he do this with three verses? Okay. I don't know. I find the word intriguing. I find it amazing. But as we have this thing, okay, finishing up chapter 4 in Colossians. Verse 16. Now when this epistle is read among you, see that it is read also in the church of Laodiceans, and that you likewise read the epistle from the Laodiceans. And say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord, that you may fulfill it. This salutation by my own hand, Paul. Remember my chains, grace be with you. Amen. Yes. Oh, gee whiz. You know, you do what you have to do here, and you just kind of roll, pretend you know what you're doing until they tell you you're messing up. So, yeah, okay. Take two. I might have a problem with my Bible because it's so beat up. Colossians. Okay, here we go. Take two. All right. Chapter 3. Wow. That is no way to start a Bible study. Because I go from... Yeah, all right. All right. Four 16. All right. Okay. I believe I just read that. All right. Gosh. Should I pray again? Okay. I'm going to go forward. Letters. This is the whole thing. This is his closing remarks. Chapter 4, verse 6. With much effort. Letters weren't just easy to come by. Letters were sent by some people who's going that way. Paul is writing to this church from Rome. Rome is 2,300 miles away. This letter took a long time. And from that to Jerusalem. So here's the whole thing is, it's carried by somebody that's going that way, or this man was sent. On aspect, this guy was sent from Rome to the Colossian church. The church in Rome was amazing. The church in Rome was growing in so many respects. God's hand was there. His placement of people was there. This church had been around for about 20-some years. So Paul is in prison at Rome. And God's hand is there. The first 100 years of the Church of Jesus Christ, the church just spread. The next 100 years, it was all across the Mediterranean, going clear up into Europe even, into Spain. So it's amazing what God was doing, but this was the beginning of this. This was what really bound it together was these early churches and their influence on the people around them. These early churches and their love for the Lord, their fact that they were willing to sacrifice so much for their faith, that they were going to go all the way for their faith, for the gospel, knowing full well it would cost them. And I look at this, do I know full well that it will cost me? Do I go all the way? Will we go all the way? This is a template, but here's this last part of this letter to the Colossian church. That I was changed by those who simply put one foot in front of the other. The whole beginning of the foundation that we're laid on as believers is one person going the extra mile, another person going the extra mile, those stepping out and saying things that in many respects was out of their comfort zone. But that's how the gospel went forward, and that's how the gospel still goes forward. God opened doors and shut doors. And all those messengers kept on keeping on. So this is the thing. This is the last part of the letter. But this is Paul's exhortation. That this epistle will be read amongst them. How dark the Roman Empire was at this time. It's today to deter crime. But also that, the desensitization. What a horrible way to die. What a dark empire this was. What an oppressive people they were. But yet, the church flourished in Rome. Rome was a huge city. Rome was an amazing city. And yet, here's the thing, is there's many believers now in Rome. Paul is writing from there in chains. So that's the whole part. The last close, chapter 4, of Colossians is all handwritten. Most of that was he had somebody write for him as he dictated. But this is the one, his handwritten love for them. I'm writing it in my own hand so that you guys know personally how I feel, that you guys know personally this is not just something I do, this is my heart for you. And what he gave the Colossian church in that letter was powerful. The fact is we are studying it today, and we have studied it in the last couple months. This letter, just this letter, and the content that's there, and the appreciation of it all. It's staggering how the church kept growing in the midst of persecution. And we look historically at how the church grew in communist China in the midst of persecution from 1948 on. 300 million believers in China today. It's funny how when we are challenged as believers, when the church is challenged, what happens? Communist Russia, all the communist bloc countries have the same story. So many of them grew in Christ. And when a lot of them were able to get out of that and come here and start churches, they split a lot. Because the focus was not on spreading the gospel. The focus was not on what was really, really important. It was on building committees. It was on no building committees. It was on this. It was on that. The distractions that we have here are different than what they have there. But here is the Colossian church. Here really is many times our whole roots are just this. The church being persecuted grows. Not only that, that the believers in that church grow. They pray more. They do more. They're desperate to hear from their God. And this is the thing. So, in chapter 4, he writes it by hand. Now, this letter is read amongst you. He wants it to spread. You guys read the letter that I give you, and it was an event to read this letter. And it was they were greatly valued. I mean, we get, well, who sends letters? We there's these, used to you'd send things in the mail, okay? Write stuff on a piece of paper and but it's different than texting and emailing, okay? But we're getting away from that. But here's the thing, is these letters were very important. And they were highly regarded, and they looked forward to expectation. When I was a kid, my grandma would send me a birthday card on my birthday, and I really was wanting that card badly because there was a for sure dollar in it, okay? But I would expect that thing to come, and when it did, it was there. The expectation of what this church had with Paul's letter was just very, very powerful to them. Now, when this letter is read amongst you, and there's room here, this was an event. This was an event that this letter's coming. This letter brought news from a faraway place. You just didn't just pack up and roll over to Rome. Probably most of them never even considered such a thing. There was a wonderment in Paul's letter. There was wonderment in the content of his letter. There was expectation in his letter. There was value in his letter. They are getting a letter from Paul the Apostle. They've never met him, but their pastor who is with him now, there is all of those different things. There's expectation that this church is getting a letter from Paul. The content, the definition that he's going to give them, the direction that he's going to give them, the value of this letter, a yearning for growth and knowledge of living the Christian life. Because it was a game changer for them. As a matter of effective ministry, when this letter came, it was not just read, it was studied, it was talked about, it was prayed about, because they knew this was from God. They knew in every aspect how much it moved them. And the fact is, when you guys are done with this letter, send it to the Laodiceans, and they have a letter for you that I wrote to them. So you have this passing of such anointed information, in many respects, totally Spirit-led. And they're not just taking it for granted. There's value in it. How many Bibles do you have? How many Bibles lay around because nobody really takes the letter to the Colossians as serious as they did? Sometimes, in many respects, I have read Colossians, and it has ministered to me when I'm so down. Because why? You put value in the Word of God and what it can do to the heart. It goes from here, and then it goes here, and then there's application, and there's enlightenment from the Word of God. Here is Paul, in many respects, writing them this, and they get this. And I ask myself, when here's this letter. Here is just a sentence here, but there's so much in that. I ask myself, what's wrong with us? What is wrong with us here? Why do we think that we need big lights, big drums, and fog machines? By the way, you guys, the fog machine's on the way. It's in the mail. Yes. It's going to bring things alive. But the lights, yeah, we're working on that. Now, here's the thing, because it's like the Word of God lightens my inner man. The Word of God empowers me and strengthens me in so many ways, gives me something that I could never pull up out of myself. It gives me strength, it gives me peace, and it gives me hope. These folks lived a real life. Genuine personal encounter with God was the Colossian church. In a Gentile city, it's the movement of the Word of God, it's the movement from the Jewish origins of it to the Gentiles. Paul was the pastor to the Gentiles. It was a move of God that was sweeping all over the Roman Empire. The timing was perfect. The Word of God went, all roads lead to Rome. It went all around. It was, again, God's timing, God's way for His Word to go through the populace in such a quick manner, yet despite persecution. Paul is encouraging them to make sure that this letter is read to the Laodiceans, and that you guys also hear what I tell them. Read this letter that I sent them. And this is template stuff for us. This is for us to draw from something so long ago, 2,000 years ago, to draw from that. It's set us up for us to draw from the Word of God, for us to realize when I take His Word carefully, thoughtfully, and intentional, and I read it that way, as these guys did, as they were instructed, there is appreciation of something of that manner studied out. As I can take this letter to the Colossians, and I can, and I will do this, and blend it in with the Ephesian letter, with Paul's closing remarks to them, with the fact that he was writing to them in the same prison and in the same time frame. It is for us to draw from the Word of God. Are we in the Word is the question. Are you in the Word is the question. Are you in the Word is the challenge. And this is not condemnation. It's like, what's wrong with you? It's the value that you place in it. It's the value of what it really can do and what it's really all about. Are we taking in worship and teaching when we come? Does it fulfill? Does it minister? Does it strengthen? Does it encourage? Does it sometimes bring tears to your eyes because you are praising a faithful God who's never let you down? Are we simply mission-minded? Because we come here for encouragement. We come here for the fact that we all are going to go back out there. And it's not real pleasant at times. It's more challenging all the time. And it draws me to pray. It draws me into my Bible. It puts me in a place where it's not that bad that I trust God. Are we taking time to start our day with Him? Are we finishing our day in reflection of how we did in serving our King? And I do not, will not, cannot, won't say this is a legalistic thing. This is what God puts in you. This is what God develops in you. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, long-suffering, is a byproduct of you letting Him work in your life. And that's the thing. It is not something you can make happen. It's something that happens when you get into prayer and you get into the Word. And not only that, you're doing it because you're desperate for it. You're doing it because you know you need it. If you don't have it, you will unravel at the seams. As we finish our day in reflection, as we finish our day in like, boy, I spoke out of turn. We're used to that, wouldn't bother you at all. It's the Word of God. It's the Spirit of God. It's the conviction of the Holy Spirit that is, in many respects, changing your inner man. Are there guards on the gate of your eyes and on your ears and on your mouth? The Holy Spirit, in many respects, teaches us, prompts us, encourages us, sometimes to not say anything, and sometimes to say something that needs said in a way that's constructive, in a way that's encouraging. That's what challenges me here. I don't know about you, but sometimes we are prone to shiny things. We are prone to things that sparkle. We are prone for so many things that in many respects stimulates our visual sensories. Sometimes we can overload on a daily basis of things that distract. They don't even have to be bad things, but there's so many things like, hey, I'll Google that, okay? We all have our international brain. Somebody says something, I remember that, so we Google that, and all of a sudden, you got a half an hour of how did that happen? And what did you Google? I don't even remember, but these are things, disciplines. These are just simple aspects of like, we do in many ways kind of get chasing squirrels. It can be subtle distractions that can blindside us. It can be subtle distractions that I need some simple basic centering on a normal Christian life. We have so many things that I know this and you know this that we never have had before. Look at us. There's many people that have never known existence outside of the internet. There was a time when we left our phones on the wall when we left home. Now we leave them in the nightstand, or we leave them, they were in my other pants pocket. We have to go get them so that they can follow us. You might miss something. These are our challenges. This is not, it's just simple things like how do I deal with this? We deal with it. When you take time to look at the detail of a simple rose, when's the last time you smelled a rose? When's the last time you just stopped and looked at something so amazing that God put together? Something that you take for granted and not even consider. You just sometimes just stop and give God glory for something like that. It brings appreciation to God and God's design and God's placement for us to enjoy. Why are there so many flowers with so many colors and so diverse and amazing? That's just flowers for our enjoyment. The scent of a rose, the scent of a tulip, they're not so good. Okay. But all of these things, all of these aspects, take time to smell the roses and take time to truly read your Bible in the exact same way. Appreciate what is there. Allow it to go from here and process and reach you where it needs to reach you. Appreciate sometimes a couple sentences that can jump out at you and absolutely change your direction of where you were going. I don't recommend this. There's people that, here's my scripture verse, you know. But there are times where that has truly happened to me. It's like it flops open and there it just jumps out. There's those times. There's other times where I'm reading. There's something I've read for so many years. And all of a sudden, this verse absolutely lit me up, ministered to me and strengthened me. That's God's timing. That's the power of His Word. There's so much to that. So verse 17, and say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord that you may fulfill it. Paul is relaying to one of their teachers in this church in the Colossae, who may have been chasing shiny things, who may have been a little distracted, or he may have been overloaded by so much waiting tables. Maybe he's ministering in an outskirts village. We don't know the whole thing, but we know he's in ministry. To what degree and what extent? Enough for Paul to just mention this. Say to this man, maybe a new pastor, maybe a teacher. But what he's doing for him, because he cares, it's like a little yellow caution light. Ministry can be seductive. Ministry can be where it just pulls you away, where you're dealing with all details, but the people are lacking. You're too busy making things happen that you're not ministering as you should. There are some people that they can go to the place where they'll just download their sermon. It's all good. Change this and that. Change the names. Use your kids' names instead of their kids' names. Off you go. I mean, these are things, okay? Sometimes it's all sorts of lazy things. These are the aspects that he has given this man a yellow light, a bit of a caution. Caution maybe burning out, maybe side issues, maybe gossip, all the different aspects, because the enemy is out to do what? Well, to mess up with the testimony. If you can take out anybody in leadership, go for it, because that's going to really discourage so many people. We've seen it. We all know this happens. This is the thing where Paul is giving this caution light, putting this thing into play. The enemy or the allurements of fame, some people start believing their own press. Constant distractions. So he's just mentioning this. He's giving that a bit of a highlight. And here's the thing too, as I can take this, as we grow and mature, and as we share, and this is a take heed. What is a take heed for us? This is a warning. This is even respect, because it can transfer even to us. This particular aspect of what he says, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord, that you may fulfill it. This term, take heed, is only found 12 times in the Bible. Okay? Jesus used it quite a bit. He said this, take heed that the little children are protected. Take heed that you watch over these precious young ones. Take heed that you keep their innocence intact. Take heed that you take care of these little ones, because there's angels watching over them that are watching you, watching over them. Be careful. That was Jesus's take heed. Jesus' other ones, take heed that no man deceive you. How can that be? If I don't know the word, if I'm not in the word, if somebody can tell me this, this, and this, and you sounds good to me, take heed that no one deceives you. Caution lights. Don't walk foolishly. Walk with wisdom. Take heed and be careful on what you listen to and measure it out. What you listen to and measure it out. Because we navigate through this world as believers, we can measure many things out by taking heed of the fact that the devil is out there to kill, steal, and destroy, and we take heed. Take heed on legalism. He's talking to the Pharisees. Don't be like them. Don't be like the legalists. Don't be like the guy who's praying and saying, thank God I'm not like that loser over there, who is crying because, God, forgive me, a sinner. Take heed that you don't get caught in self-righteousness. Take heed that the disciples, and he's telling them, you guys, you need to know this. Take heed. You will be persecuted. Take heed that as you go forward and as you challenge the kingdom of darkness, you will be persecuted. Take heed, any of you that wants to go farther with Jesus Christ, you're going to have resistance, but that resistance is going to make you better. Take heed. Take heed of false Jesuses. We have cults all over the place. Their explanation of Jesus is not biblical. Take heed that you know what that looks like. Because if not, there will be millions lost in deception. Nothing is new under the sun. They had their issues. We even have ours today. Take heed on how you build your life in Christ. Take heed that your foundation is solid and secure, and that it is something that God will do and shape you. Take heed. Take heed that you don't fall away by unbelief. That you fall away by just getting sloppy with your agape. Take heed of the freedom that you have in Christ so that you don't abuse it. That you don't say, well, I'm saved by grace. I can do about anything. Take heed. You can't. The consequences of your sin will not be refrained from you. You will reap them. Take heed to self-pride before you fall. You're not all that. You never will be all that. Be careful that you don't think that you are. Take heed to destructive gossip. Be careful what you repeat. Be careful what you listen to. And take heed to your ministry is what he's telling this man. To be focused so that you fulfill all that ministry requires. Whatever it was, he knew, nobody else knew. Take heed. This was a gentle, while I'm here, I'm just going to throw this out there. A caution light for this man, and I would probably wager, it's not good to wager though, but I would assume that this, in many respects, was for him. And it's like, he's probably, it was probably very constructive. Because when the Holy Spirit convicts and one adheres and goes forward with that, we walk out a better person. This was all these take heeds were not there for gain. And all the things that it was there for reflection of the cost of forward movement of the gospel. So long ago, as you look back at how you have moved the gospel forward, how God has used your whole life as a testimony, more powerful than you even realize. How as you stepped out, things do happen at times. But this is what's so fascinating about the Word of God. This is 2,000 years ago, you guys. I relate to it. You relate to it. Nothing has changed. But look at Paul's letter to the Roman church. Look at the fact that he's in prison. Look at the fact that he's, in many respects, he will be killed by the Roman Empire. But look at the fact that in the midst of all of that, his letter to the Colossians, his letter to the Ephesians, and his crowning jewel of his letter to the Romans that has sustained, given direction in many respects by the power of God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, this is what we stand upon. There's such a solid foundation that we have. Take heed. This church and this city that Paul is writing from, this chains that he's under, it's just going to continue to blow up, and the church is going to just go everywhere. So I want us to flip over to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I'll make sure I get that right. Okay. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I'm going to try to bring my new Bible next time. My other one, I dropped it, and it broke in half, so now I got this one. So, too much tape. Here we go. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Here's Paul writing to the Ephesian church. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, same time frame, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called, in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, and God and Father, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. Prison life. Here's another setting. Here's a whole nother setting for our consideration. From a prisoner's viewpoint, from the fruit of prayer. Because here you are in prison with these guys, you are forced to have quality time. It had to be awful. Yet I think that what Paul says here is golden. Is golden. Here they are in many respects in a setting doing time. Your limitations are, you know, there's your parameters. This is the whole thing. Doing time. Therefore, as a prisoner of the Lord, I beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. When you're in prison, there's not a whole lot going on. Lowliness and gentleness with long suffering, bearing with one another in love. They learned to bear with one another in love. They learned because of just the confinement of it all. I mean, you know how it is. It's about 3 days when the guests start, you know, needing to leave, you know. These guys needed this. This is so many respects Paul's part. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And they are the body of Christ in those confinements. There's one body and one Spirit, just as you were called, in one hope of your calling. These guys were united in their mission. They were united in the fact that they are in bondage. They are confined. They are, in many respects, learning to love each other. All those idiosyncrasies, all those things of day after day after day after day after day. All of those aspects. And they learn to love. And he's transferring this, telling the Ephesians, hey, you guys, learn to love. Learn to love. Walk worthy of the calling. Walk worthy. Life brings its challenges. You guys know that. I know that. Church life and fellowship requires long suffering, sharing. These guys learned that because of the limited space. As in Paul's bondage perspective, keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So what's so easy here is when things go wrong. I've seen it over and over again, and you guys have too in many respects. Well, they change the color of the curtains, or we're leaving. You drag your children away. The fact that, like, is this something that we do? Is you build community. And when things aren't quite right, we roll and show our children when things aren't right. You don't build the bond of peace. You talk about this, you talk about that, and off you go. It's this whole part where it is the Colossian church where we're just us and there's all those guys out there. We don't have that. It's just us and there's a whole bunch of other guys out there that have another thing. But it's like at the end of the day, it is the church of Jesus Christ, universal, triumphant. You can't get away from that. You can't get away from the Holy Spirit. You can't get away from the things He wants to teach you. But you can be unteachable. You can be this. You can be that. You can grow into, I'm just done. God's never done with you. There are times he has put people in my way that grind me. And it's been helpful. It has been an absolute, I needed this guy to show me that I need to repent here. I needed this person to give me such empathy that I would not have had if I hadn't endured them. There's some people whose ministry is to increase the patience of the saints. That's their job. But here's the thing. We all, in every way, can become a strength in a community. Become something like, okay, what can you give me here? Or how can I serve you? How do we serve the Lord? You guys, a lot of you don't really, we have a school here. A part of our ministry. We have 115 students that we deal with. This place gets used. We have ministries here. We have Trail Life, which is 70-some young boys learning how to be men. 70-some young girls outside of our school learning and being discipled on how to be a woman of God. We've got our sports teams, which deals with a lot of homeschool kids all through here. It's like this is ministry 101. This is, in many ways, is like doing what Jesus said. Be careful you don't mess with kids. We want these kids to be equipped, to have memories, to have such structure, community reaching that. You think the enemy doesn't want that? The biggest thing that the enemy wants to do is destroy our children. We see it all today. We see this whole thing coming down that is like, what are you doing to your children? As we raise them biblically, as we invest in them biblically, as we put all these things together, it is that thing. What a precious treasure we have. Pray for us. Pray all these different things that they go together. It is used, this building is used, this place is used, and is supposed to be. As we recognize our mission, we recognize the aspect that as we reach out, what God can do. Yes, we do grind on one another, and this is Paul's whole thing. Keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And in this wording, it's just like ligaments, in the bond of peace. The ligaments hold this together, move that and hold that one. It's that whole aspect. The ligaments hold us together. The bones, the muscle, all of the body of Christ, it must function in a way that we realize this is how it works. Pray for those who persecute you. Love those people. Make yourself available. Sometimes we make ourselves vulnerable. And boy, can you get hurt. I'm pretty vulnerable up here sometimes. But you know what? You just have to do what you have to do. And share what you know. You just share what you know. All the things we go through are never in vain. All our heartaches, all our trials, all our tribulations are not in vain. We are to invest in one another. Young guys, old guys, young ladies, older ladies. It is all of that is what we put this thing together and realize this is how it works. Church life and fellowship. Paul's, in many respects, perspective to keep the unity of the Spirit. Verse 4, there is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. His worldwide view of the church is right here. We have such rich and personal accounts of his faithfulness. We have such rich and personal accounts of a transformed life. We have some rich and personal accounts of we've seen it in many people around us. We have seen the faithfulness of God. We have seen what he can do to somebody who submits their life unto him. And his total grace in our lives, his grace in your life. He took you right where you were at. You didn't have to clean up for him. He cleaned you up. We are one body, one Spirit. And we know this. And we were called into such a hope. Don't let this just get away from you. This is us. This is the genuine value of a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we are so underserved in this respect. The bond of peace that holds us together and surpasses all human understanding. We are to share that, to live that, to be that. One Lord. One faith. One Lord and one faith, because it covers every culture. It covers every language, because the heart of men are empty without Jesus Christ, no matter where you come from. The message of the gospel has been spread all over the world, embraced, encouraged, and in many respects changed lives the exact same way as ours is. They have different principalities they're dealing with, different issues they're dealing with, but one God, our God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, is whom they pray to and seek counsel from, and guided by the same Holy Spirit that guides you and guides me. The Holy Spirit doesn't speak in English. Just to me. No, the Holy Spirit works in our hearts, speaks to the inner man, and we understand so much. It enlightens us so much. It changes us in every way. One God, one Father, and to know His heart, to know the Father heart of God, to know how much He loves you, how patient He is with you. Our God reigns, and He is above it all. Our God absolutely reigns, and He's above it all. One God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. And in you all. Our sphere here on earth, our atmosphere around our earth, our amazing orbit around the sun and the spin of our world and the little tilt that He put there made a perfect place for us to live. He is over all and in all and through all. Just that amazing dance in the universe to keep us alive. And we take it for granted. We can. It's easy. It's just there. It is amazing. It would have been this way or that way. This is the perfect thing for us that God created. And the moon does what it does. Makes young guys kiss girls. No, it's the ebb and the flow of the whole thing is gorgeous. It's amazing. The creation of what God can do and has done and is continuing to do in our lives. Through every atom and every molecule, all creation tells us that His signature is totally written on our very DNA. Yours is different than mine. It's amazing. These things, to stop and consider the Church of Jesus Christ and what a believer looks like and the miracle of salvation. And He is in you all. Christ in us, the hope of glory. This is what unites us together. This is what makes us who we are. This is, in many respects, allows us to affect the world outside of these rooms, outside of these walls. And in you all, Christ in us, we serve a mighty God. He hears our prayers. He calls us His own. And Paul's reminding them with such a blessing that he gives at the end of each of these things. These long-awaited letters that he wrote to the Ephesian church, the Colossian church, the Philippian church, were absolute golden. As we finish with Colossians, what Paul says to them is just, again, powerful. This, my salutation by my hand, Paul. That's kind of cool. Grace to you. I'm saved by grace. You're saved by grace. We live in grace. all because of the cross. All because his body was broken for you. All because he shed his perfect blood for you. That I'm here today. That you are here today because of the cross. Because of the power of a transformed life. Because of the fact that he paid your debt you couldn't pay. And he paid your debt that he didn't owe. It binds us together. It holds us together. And it keeps us together. As we recognize this, and if you guys could start the, I want to have communion today. If you guys could start distributing that. As we put this into play, and as Jesus gathered together his disciples, turn to Luke chapter 22, verse 14. Jesus was, he couldn't wait to have communion with these guys to celebrate the Passover. And when he had come, he sat down. All the 12 disciples were with him. This wasn't their first Passover. This was going to be their last Passover they had with their Lord. And as he gathered them together, he fervently desired to have this Passover with them. And when he had came, he sat down, verse 14, and the 12 apostles were with him. Then he said to them, with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. And I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. The upper room, that whole amazing setting. How powerful that is. As he gathers them together and has this Passover meal. Yeah. He was going to show them what this really means and who he was and what he's all about. Verse 15. And what we have here is hope. Then he said to them, 16, I say to you, I will no longer eat of this or fulfill it until the kingdom of God comes. What he said to them, they thought, well, this is great. It's been a good week coming into Jerusalem and everything happening, all the power that's happening. It's going to be a good time that Jesus is going to finally take over and rule this place. They had no idea what he was going to do. When he told them what was going to happen. These questions and illustrations that took place is this. We have hope here. He says, for I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of heaven. Then he said, and he took this cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide among yourselves, for I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given to you, which do this in remembrance of me. He's saying things that they're not even understanding. This is a setting that they haven't heard before, and he's allowing this to happen. This was a perfect setting for him, because in the Seder dinner, in the cup that he picked up, it was not just a random cup. It meant something. He was the Redeemer. And the bread that he ate in the three different, this was a whole aspect of showing them that he was their Messiah. And they took this communion without realizing the depth of what they were doing until after the cross. And I can imagine what their communion was like. Their first communion with full understanding of what the bread meant and what the wine meant. That his blood was shed and his body was broken in order for us to have fellowship with God. But here we have them here. They're not even getting what's going on, but they are being obedient. And he is investing in them. That was a night of absolute investment. Jesus was going to step from that room into literal hell. But he took time with the boys. He took time with them. He invested with them. He invested in them. And in that respect and in that way, he's doing something powerful here. Here's the thing, too. He is teaching you things that you don't understand. He's bringing you through things that you need in order that you won't shrink back and fall away. He's equipping you, strengthening you, enlightening you. And his word is doing it. And his spirit is teaching you. As they partook, after it all came down, that's when they were lit up. He did this really so that it would come into light. This is what binds us together as believers worldwide. This is why we come together in communion as a family with a recognition of the amazing cost of our salvation. It was free for us, but it cost a lot. To know this is an absolute wow moment. So here is the thing. As Jesus brought them together and he shared with them what's going to happen. And he gave them the bread, divided amongst yourself. And then he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take the bread." And then he took the cup and he gave thanks, knowing full well what it meant, knowing full well what was ahead of him, knowing full well that he was going all the way for you and for me. If I was the only one, he would have done it for me. His love for us is absolutely immense, unfathomable. Don't take it for granted. Know that this is something that we have a privilege to partake of. The fact of what he did for us. Take the cup. Lord, are we ready for that day when your church, your bride, will celebrate, Lord God, in the great wedding feast? Lord, it is what it's all about. It is what you've done with those 12 disciples, what you've done with the one that rejected you, what you did, Lord, so long ago, and how the church has grown and how we are held together, past, present, and future, Lord God, how our salvation cost immensely. But Lord, the fact that we are here this morning, each one of us, an absolute miracle of your perfect timing, of your perfect steps, Lord God, of your perfect will. Lord, let us not take for granted our salvation. Let us not take for granted our Christianity, and let us not take for granted one another. May we hold one another in high regard. May we hold one another as precious, Lord God. May we, Lord God, be effective in the world outside of these walls, Lord. May we go forward with the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, as we come together this morning and we came together recognizing, God, all that you've done, as we came together as family with all these precious children in front of us, Lord God, Lord, let us not take for granted all that you have for us. Lord, we thank you that we have hope, and don't ever let us forget that. We lift these things up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. These are blessings that we can share and give to one another. We have the ability to bless people as believers. God bless you goes a long, long ways to people that don't know our God, and that comes from our mouth, and God hears that. Bless people around you. And do this. Take time to smell the flowers. God bless. Amen.
Why don't we all stand up for this last song?
I will worship
with all of my heart,
and I will praise you
with all of my strength,
and
I will seek you with all of my days, and I will follow all of your ways. I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise.
I will bow down
and hail you as King.
Hail you as King.
And I will serve you and give you everything.
I will lift up
my eyes to your throne. I will trust you alone.
Yeah. Trust you alone.
And I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my. I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise.
Ooh, yeah. You alone now.
Father, we just thank you that you are our hope and our strength, our confidence. We place it all in you, Jesus, and ask as we go throughout the rest of the week, help us to seek your face and always keep you on the forefront of our minds. You alone are worthy to be praised, and as we leave this place, we continue to praise you and lift you up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.